Wanted to talk a little bit today about SPS, which means sanitary and phytosanitary controls, and I'll go into that a little bit. But we call it the trade tactic of choice. It's something that our trading partners are using more and more to block trade, and it's something that gives us a lot of headaches, and we spend a lot of time working on this problem. So how does this work? There we go. So here's a little outline of what I wanted to go over today. Probably some things you're already aware of, but what I'd like to say first is, if I don't want you to be bored, and if I'm not hitting the points that you want to know about or you want to talk about, just raise your hand and say, I don't want to know about that. I have a question. So I'd rather we did it a little bit informally, and that way I can get to what you need to find out or what I can provide to you. And if I don't have the response or answer, I'll get it. I'll try to find it. So, but anyway, we'll talk a little bit about the situation right now for the livestock and meat industry in terms of supply and demand, some productivity gain information, and about the importance of trade to our industry now in the United States. Then I want to get into a little bit about technology, and a lot of this relates to feed additives, but also in general SPS concerns, international trade, whether it's the WTO, World Trade Organization, SPS agreement, Codex, what we see as the nexus between what some perceive as public safety issues versus protectionism, and more information about and some comments about beta agonist bans in key markets. Also, I call practice what we preach. In some ways, I say we're not without sin in some of these issues here in the United States, and I want to talk about that. And finally, what we can do as industry to hopefully resolve some of these things and move forward. Very quickly about AMI, we're the oldest and largest representative of meat packers in the United States, represent 95% of red meat and 70% of turkey. We are based in Washington. We had been in Chicago for many years, moved to Virginia, and in the 90s moved to Washington. And as you may know, we monitor legislation. We have a lobbying office. We do a lot of media interaction for our member companies. We have, obviously, a board of directors, which are the CEOs of the major meat packers and equipment suppliers in the United States. And we have about a staff of about 27 professionals in policy. I'm in charge of an international trade policy committee, which includes about 20 to 25 companies interested in export markets. We have about 160 meat packers and about what we call two supplier members. These are the equipment and supplier groups that supply everything in a meat processing plant, and there's about 225 of those. We have joined forces this year with U.S. Poultry and Egg Association and the American Feed Industry Association, and we just had our first combined show in Atlanta at the end of January. Had about 400,000 square feet of space, 27,000 visitors, so this is a new thing for us, and we're trying to consolidate and do a better job for our members. All right, I want to talk a little bit about the importance of trade to our industry. And I'll talk about some trends in terms of both meat supplies and especially beef being constrained, what is happening with per capita consumption in the United States and how that's driving our policies, and some information about new technologies and trade, as we see as opportunities and others use as barriers to our exports. As you know, cattle inventories were going up for decades and have leveled off since the 80s and are even dropping. This is our worldwide numbers. And if you look at the U.S. specifically, our numbers are really dropping off for various reasons, unfortunately, sort of a combination of things. The recession obviously has had an impact, the droughts in the Southwest, the drought in Northwest Mexico has also had an impact. As you know, we imported quite a bit of feeder cattle from Mexico for our members, and also Mexico has been involved in exporting quite a bit of live animals to Turkey and other markets. Unfortunately, one of our major members closed a slaughter facility in Plainview, Texas. This is what happens when inventories go down and margins are squeezed. And a very unfortunate incidents, but that's the environment that we're currently in. If you look at it in terms of the three NAFTA countries, the red line is Mexico, dropping off significantly in recent years. Canada sort of hanging in there, but also dropping, and I think we think that the U.S. is going to start to come back. As you know, cattle prices have been very high, feed prices have been very high, and margins have been squeezed. But we think, we're hoping that it will start to turn around and we'll see our stocking levels come up a little bit. We'll talk somewhat some more about the impact of the country origin of labeling law that's going to affect in May and what additional impact this might have.
Is this beef and dairy? Is this beef only or beef and dairy?
For country origin labeling? This is a beef and dairy. Yeah. Thank you. Quickly looking at the swine stocking rates, as you can see, it has leveled off as well. But if you look at Canada and the U.S., you can see that the hog breeding herd has dropped off. These are relative to 2005 at 100%, has dropped off significantly in recent years. We hope this will start to come back as well as we move into the rest of this year. But the decline in numbers doesn't mean less meat necessarily, as you know, and this is a result of genetic improvements, improved animal husbandry, improved feed technology, the use of beta agonists, and so forth. So, but at some point, you'll see I have another chart here, another chart that will give a little schematic of what's going on. I think as commercial cattle slaughter has leveled off, we'd have had the increase in beef production, which is the increase in carcass weights, increase in yields, and so forth. But our domestic consumption, our disappearance is starting to drop. And I think this is why our international markets are becoming increasingly important to our members. I'm going to look a little bit at per capita meat consumption as it trends down and how our consumers in emerging markets are coming on very strongly. As a result, prices are up. So supplies are down, prices are up, demand is up overseas. I do want to talk about per capita consumption just a little bit. This shows the global data for the United States in terms of beef, pork, and poultry. And as you can see, it's dropping off significantly over the last couple of years. If you look globally, we take one metric, is if you look at global GDP going up and beef and hog numbers, cattle and hog numbers being relatively stable. I don't like this chart, this graph so much because I'm not comfortable with the cattle number, but I think the idea is that it has been relatively straight-lined, whereas GDP is going up, and what does that mean? That translates into demand overseas, and as per capita consumption has dropped in the United States, in markets such as China, it looks very, very promising. The Chinese, I lived there for a couple of years, and had a real difficult time understanding that culture and what was going on there, but it's fascinating, and I study it a lot now to try to get more information and see what's going on. But the point is, the Chinese, it's a very interesting place. If you look at the data, in 2012, they imported 1.1 million metric tons of beef, pork, and poultry from the United States, over $2 billion worth. With trade restrictions, so we'll talk about that. But China has 50 million sows on a land area about the same size as the United States, and their annual production is 700 million pigs. It's just incredible numbers. Plus, they have 1.3 billion people on the same land area. So you can imagine the resource constraints that they have, the water pollution, the air pollution. It is a very, very, I think, difficult environment. And what's becoming increasingly important there is this emphasis on food safety, food security, and sustainability. And it's something that's just now starting to drive some of their policies. If you look at what's happened since, 2000, with WTO accession and this rapidly expanding middle class, when you have this rapid increase in disposable income, consumers turn to more sophisticated types of protein. And this is what's been happening. And it's driving their import demand. They use all of their arable land in China. There's none left. There's severe water shortages, especially in the North China Plain where they grow most of their grains. So in my opinion, they'll start to increasingly use biotechnology, feed technologies, anything they can use, become more efficient and more productive on the land that they have. And for our members, this is the most important market we're looking at in terms of future, in terms of what products and diversified products we might be able to sell into this country. So it's very important. Looking back just globally, I want you to recognize the numbers, the volumes here in terms of our exports becoming more important. You know, if you add these up, it's over $17 billion in trade for beef, pork, poultry, variety meats, as well as muscle cuts. Over 7 million metric tons. But in each line, I want you to see that there's some repetition here. Notice that Canada, Mexico, and beef. Canada, Mexico, on pork. Canada, Mexico, poultry. NAFTA partners come very, very important to us. And with our cool legislation coming on, we stand to really hurt them. And this does not make sense to us. Why are we going to hurt our major customers for our products? So I'd like to talk more about that in a few minutes. If you look at this is a volume, this is the value of trade for beef, pork, and poultry from the United States. And the maroon line there is the result of the BSE case, the Canadian dairy cow we had come in. But you see it's come back. And demand is back up. If you look at volumes on beef, we're still pretty far off. But look what's happened in value. We're back. We're way above it. And it's looking very good. This is important, obviously, to the long-term viability and health of our industry. So we will continue on this path and hope to both service these markets and diversify the products that we're making available both to our customers here in the States and in other markets. Turning to SPS and technology and trade, and I use the term the trade tactic of choice because although new production technologies have allowed us to service markets, and it's become increasingly important to have this available to supply not only our domestic demand, but also foreign demand. We see that countries are increasingly using SPS barriers to block trade for various reasons. And in many cases, it's they have very strong farm lobbies. They're interested in promoting their own domestic production, so they will use these unjustified trade barriers in order to block product, increase prices, and make it more economical for local producers to produce. If we go back to the premise that we work on in terms of the WTO SPS chapter, all nations who are signatories to the WTO have agreed that any regulations or standards they put in place to protect human or plant life is going to be based on science. It'll be based on international standards, and it will not be arbitrarily or unjustifiably discriminate between countries that are members of the WTO. So, members have two options. They can either base their measures on existing standards, for us would be the OIE or the Codex, or they can base their measures on a valid scientific risk assessment. So, we look at it, whether this is public safety, is it really a food safety concern, or is it protectionism? So, this is something we are dealing with every day. It is very frustrating work. I think in the first example here, I'd use Russia at the top, where they've recently banned U.S. imports, U.S. Beef, pork, and turkey because of ractopamine residues. Well, that's fine in a sense for beef and pork. It's not justified, but we don't use ractopamine in turkey, but they're using it as an excuse to block the product from coming in. So we are in the process right now, this week, last week and this week, coming up with a system with USDA that we'll be able to verify and guarantee in a manner that's not trade restrictive that the product that we're going to ship will have, will certify that, I guess the term they use is never fed. So that's what we're working on right now. In the second example, and I use the term technical complexities associated with selling risk assessments. And I use an example that I learned in China. I spent a year negotiating with the Chinese government to create a food safety agreement document. And it was arduous work. It was every week, you know, going through, sitting down, and every sentence and every word and everything just right, all this sort of thing. We got into this discussion with this fellow. I got to know him fairly well, and he's still there. communicate with him. We got into a discussion about science-based decision-making, and the underlying argument was ractopamine again. And finally he goes, well, you know what? Maybe our science is different than yours. And I was stunned, and I just sat there looking at him. I didn't have an answer. But I thought about it for days, and I think what he meant was that their diet is different than ours. Their diet is heavily skewed towards all of the things that we don't eat. We don't eat chicken paws. We don't eat pig's ears. We don't eat snouts. We don't eat jowls. Or pig's feet. Or offal, and to the extent that they do. So his point was that when we're doing a risk assessment, we have to take all of these other products into account. And that the best example I have is when I'll get into the Codex decision of last summer, the Chinese said, well, we have to do a risk assessment on pig lung tissue. But you know, we don't eat pig lung tissue, and we don't trade it. But this is an example of something that was of a concern to them that we were not addressing, and so this is where the different science comes in. So the point is, we've been fighting these things for years, and we'll continue to fight them. We have a process in the WTO of notifications of new standards and measures. There's a procedure for that. And since the early 1990s, the average tariff rates have been dropping worldwide because of the WTO, because of NAFTA, because of the free trade agreements with Korea, Colombia, and Panama have come on, so forth. And we're negotiating now with the Trans-Pacific Partnership Group, and Europe is going to start up this year. So I don't think this is exactly a coincidence that there's more notifications to the WTO by all these countries, but it doesn't necessarily translate into barriers. It's their notifications of changes in standards. But certainly, I think there is some correlation there. I just haven't been able to figure it out yet. Very quickly on Codex, you may know all of this. I think the point I really wanted to make was at the bottom, and the example here is where countries try to circumvent the Codex standards process, and particularly the European Union is good at this, in introducing something called the negative list. And a good example would be the previous speaker earlier today talked about peroxyacetic acid as a PRT. Well, in a negative list, if it's codified in Codex, the EU would be able to say, well, we don't want to use peroxyacetic acid, we don't approve it. And they would be able to do that without a valid risk assessment or international standard. And that's very dangerous for our business and what we're trying to do. So this is something we're fighting the EU on in the Codex arena. I wanted to give a little bit on the ractopamine issue. We've worked very hard on this with NPPC and other groups. It was this, as you know, ractopamine hydrochloride was approved back in 1999. It's been adopted by 26 countries. And it had been approved three separate times by the JECFA scientists. And finally, it was adopted by Codex with the Codex recommended, with the JECFA recommended MRLs, maximum residue levels, last July, a very close vote in Codex. But despite that action, we're very glad that Codex finally came through and approved it, because we believe very strongly that we need Codex as a viable institution. We must have a group like this, scientific verification of standards, as the basis for trade. We must have it. So, European Union has, by law, a ban on beta agonists. So, this will be an issue in the upcoming FDA negotiations. We've told them that. Russia, as I said, recently banned beef, pork, and turkey from the United States. We're trying to work through that. Back to China, it's interesting that, in my opinion, their problem is not ractopamine. Their problem is clenbuterol. They've had a problem with clenbuterol misuse in China. They've had a problem with melamine misuse in baby formula and animal feed, as you know. Their problem is rule of law. Their problem is accountability and being able to control their producers and and they've asked us privately, say, how do we do this? How do you do it? And for us, you know, it's science. It's based upon how products are used. It's economic. You can't use more product and have it be profitable. So we're trying to work quietly with the Chinese and help them with this issue because it's important. It's an important market for us. So the other point is that China was producing rectopamine and clenbuterol using rectopamine locally. We talked to local producers, say, well, yeah, I'd be stupid not to use it. So, but no one would identify themselves or help us out in that regard. Turning to Taiwan, they last year approved U.S. beef with rectopamine residues within the Codex MRLs, but not for pork. So why would they do that? Because they have a very strong pork producers council, simply said. And so I think eventually the government will come around, but they need to resolve their domestic producer situation. We use Japan as, or I use Japan as the example of how we would like to see it, if we could, in places like Europe and Russia and China. Because Japan bans the use of ractopamine domestically, but they allow imports within the Codex recommended MRLs. That's fine. What every country decides to do domestically is their business. We shouldn't have a say in that. But don't block trade if the science supports the use of a particular product. So that resonates with some and others. I'll explain in a second. Bans on things like ractopamine, again, they do have a significant impact on trade. If you look at the combined beef and pork exports, five-year average versus what happened last year, significant drop in our shipments to Taiwan. And if you look at Russia, I mean, we don't even use ractopamine in turkeys, but look what happened with the ban. You know, it just went down by 90%. So this is the kind of thing we're fighting, you know, that bans are, when justified, okay, but look what happens when nothing is backed up by a risk assessment or science. This is my we're not without sin slide for the United States. We do talk about science-based decision-making and the efficacy of Codex and WTO, but we're not alone in making mistakes, I don't think, or having unjustified barriers. If you know something about the Chinese cooked poultry issue, this has been going on 9 years now. How am I doing on time? And it's very difficult to get approved to ship a meat product to the United States, first of all. For China, it's extra hard because of all the problems I cited before. However, going on 9 years is probably not reasonable. And we could have an entire seminar on this one issue. So I don't want to go into it in too much detail. But we need to address it. We need to, if we're going to preach science, then we need to address this issue. The next one is the BSE comprehensive rule. We have delayed this. We being, I'd say, the government delayed this, and it's still pending. We need to do this. Hopefully we'll get negligible risk from the OIE for BSE in May, and maybe this will go through at the same time. I mentioned Canada and Mexico earlier as being important markets. We now have this country of origin labeling issue coming up, which is going to be implemented on May 23rd. We think this will be devastating to our trading partners, because not only you can no longer say product of the U.S. and Canada, you have to say born, raised, and slaughtered in the United States, born in Canada, raised, and slaughtered in the United States, born in Mexico, raised, and slaughtered, or something of those combinations. And it's going to be devastating because the packer processors are going to need to segregate all these animals in the operation. There's no room left in the plant. I mean, you can't do it. So either going to make companies force them to buy all American cattle or pigs, or you're going to shut companies down. And I thought we were supposed to be helping people. Well, anyway, that's my editorial. So, real quickly, Lori and I worked real hard on the rectopamine MRL, and I'll just say that what resonated was we went to small countries and we said, this issue is not about rectopamine. It's about something you may want in the future and you may need a Codex standard for it. And we explained that to them. They thought about it, and they said, okay, will support you. I mentioned the TTIP is Europe, TPP. We want binding and enforceable provisions. It's very difficult to get that. And we're fighting other countries like Indonesia. Very quickly, we hope to educate our trading partners, customers about Codex and why it should be strong, why we should have binding measures, and the importance of emerging markets and new technologies. So we need technology to think in the future to produce the food that we're going to need in the next 50 years. And we need international trade in order to reach our customers. So hopefully we'll be successful in fighting these bans and unjustified restrictions.